Hey guys, Greg Fox here, and today I wanted to expand on our recent gas furnace troubleshooting series. The easy guide to diagnosing a bad furnace inducer motor will fill you in on what the inducer motor does, why it's important, the common ways that I've found the inducer motor fails, and how to let the customer know what you've found. That's coming up here on Fox Family Heating and Air. And if this is your first time watching our channel, please click subscribe down here on the bottom right. And if you click that little bell next to it, you'll be notified of all of our videos as they come out. First, I want to give fair warning to anyone watching this video that's not already an experienced technician in the HVAC field. This video is for educational purposes only, and Fox Family Heating and Air does not recommend anyone other than a professional to start opening the furnace up and trying to diagnose the failure going on with your system. There are high and low voltages that can shock a person. There are also lots of moving things that can damage body parts, namely hands and fingers. The furnace also produces hot surfaces within the furnace compartments and around the housing, which can cause severe burns. There's an actual flame that is produced by the ignition and startup of a gas furnace, which can cause severe burns and damage to the person or the property. So first, as a technician, you have to know the sequence of events that occurs for the gas furnace to start up properly. It's really easy, and you should have this memorized before you can even consider being qualified to start troubleshooting. Power to the furnace control board, the thermostat signals the call for heat, the inducer motor kicks on, the pressure switch proves that the inducer motor is operating correctly, the igniter activates, the gas valve energizes, flame pours across the burners, the flame sensor then proves that all the burners are lit, and the blower starts forcing air through the duct system. When a furnace begins a new cycle, the inducer motor is the first thing that you should see kick on. 120 volts is applied through the wires coming from the control board to the inducer motor. This starts the inducer motor for up to 60 seconds before anything else even happens. It's a safety feature that creates a negative pressure or a draft, which purges the heat exchanger of any poisonous gases, namely the byproducts of combustion. It makes the air inside the hollow tubes of the heat exchanger cleaner when the flame kicks on. When we have cleaner air inside the heat exchanger at the time of combustion, the efficiency of the furnace increases. Without going into it too much, there's a safety device called a pressure switch that activates when the diaphragm inside of it recognizes the suction or the purging action of the inducer motor. There's another video called The Easy Guide to Diagnosing a Bad Pressure Switch, and I'll make sure that it's attached to the end screen on this video so that you can check it out. But first, you're wanting to know a little bit more about the inducer motor and how to troubleshoot it. If the inducer motor doesn't turn on when it's supposed to, the furnace will recognize this and shut down. It'll wait a bit and try again. If the motor doesn't start after 3 to 5 tries, the control board will stop sending voltage to the inducer motor and essentially lock it out from attempting anymore. If the correct voltage is applied to the motor and it's not turning on, something's not right. Let's find out why. Unplug the furnace, which removes power to the system. Is the base of the motor warm or hot to the touch? This means that it's been trying to spin, but something's holding it up. Is the flywheel on the motor or the actual squirrel cage unable to spin when you manually try to turn it? This could be a solid indicator that the motor is bad and needs to be replaced. One reason the shaft of the motor locks up is because the bearings on the motor could be seized, preventing it from turning. Another reason has to do with the windings inside the motor. One of them could be open, usually the start winding in this case. And finally, some motors have a capacitor that starts the motor and regulates the voltage while it's running. If it's a bad capacitor, a new one should get it going again. One of the first indicators that an inducer motor is on borrowed time is if it starts making odd noises. Sometimes it's a rattling noise, a clanking noise, chattering, pinging, shaking, a wobbling noise, you name it. If it comes on and it's running any other way than what you interpret as normal based on your training and experience with your properly operating furnaces, you can take a look at it and see if it's something that you can physically adjust. If not, the inducer motor should be considered bad. Why? Because it's not running to manufacturer specs. Think about it like this. Would the builder of the furnace, who takes a ton of pride in the operation of their system, send this furnace out into the field to be installed knowing the inducer motor is making this god-awful noise? The answer is a resounding no, And you have to know that and be comfortable telling the customer this. Because many inducer motors are nearly impossible to rebuild, an entirely new unit has to be purchased in most cases when one wears out. One of the exceptions to this is the occasional carrier or Bryant furnace. So at this point, I'm gonna go into what I need my technicians to do since this video is also for them. Inducer motors are ordered through the manufacturer. And since we have flat rate pricing, which includes the cost of parts, labor, and the warranty, and you wanna know the pricing and availability before you talk to the customer, because you wanna minimize the number of times that you need to bring the customer information. Coming to them and telling them that the inducer motor is bad, just to hear them say, okay, how much is it? Making you go back and find out, just to come back and tell them it's such and such price. You get the approval on the price, but now they wanna know when the repair will take place. This makes you have to call back to the parts warehouse to ask when the part will be available. Then you have to go back and tell them that the part will be in around 5 to 7 business days from the factory. All of this back and forth can be avoided if you have the information for them up front, before you even tell them about the diagnosis. Even if they don't go with your repair, you have the information that you need and you can log it into your file for the customer in case they call back approving the repair, say a month from now. Once we determine the pricing and availability, it's time to talk to the customer about our diagnosis. We explain what we found, let the customer know the price, and let them know when we can come back to repair the system. And just a word to the wise, good communication between you and the customer would be telling them that you need to change this part on the furnace before you can see if anything else is wrong with the system. Sometimes you'll get a customer that asks, "So this is going to fix my system, right?" Well, you don't really know because you haven't seen what the rest of the system does on startup or shutdown. It's very likely that the rest of the system will work since multiple failures are pretty rare. But you're gonna feel like a jerk if you forget to tell them that you have to see how the rest of the system operates after you replace the inducer motor. Coming back to them after you've replaced the motor saying, "Oh yeah, now your gas valve is bad and that's gonna be another $600. So just remember, without a properly functioning inducer motor, there's no way to tell if the rest of the system is gonna work to manufacture specs. If it is a part that's available for pickup, call the office to determine a date to pick it up and return to replace the part. If it's a part that needs to be shipped, we want to let the customer know that the part should be arriving at said date and that we're going to call to schedule the appointment when the part arrives. Another thing that you'd want to communicate to the customer and to the office is how long the repair will take. During the installation of the inducer motor, we need to make sure that we either replace the gasket, which usually comes with the new motor, or make a gasket with new high temp silicone. Once installed, a good technician will test the system for proper operation to make sure that there's no other issues with the furnace. So just to recap, inducer motors pull the flame through the heat exchanger and vent the exhaust through the roof. In order to determine the failure of an inducer motor, we need to verify that proper voltage is being applied to it. If the motor has proper voltage, the capacitor tests good, and it's not turning on, the motor's bad. If it's making a lot of noise, the homeowner should know that the part is working, but it's on borrowed time. If this is your first time watching our channel, please click subscribe down here on the bottom right. And if you click that little bell next to it, you'll be notified of all of our videos as they come out. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.
You're watching Fox Family Heating and Air. Don't forget to subscribe. And check out more of our videos by clicking on the right side of the screen.